All righty. Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
Y'all having a good day today?
Yes.
Yes? Fine and dandy. That's good. That's good. So I'll go ahead and stand and turn to page number 162. 162.
Burden of my heart rolled away. It was there.
I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. But drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away, 'tis all that I can do. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Let's do one more. One more. If I'm correct, it's 391. It is not 391, it's 397. 397. In the harvest field now ripened, there's work for all to do. Hark, the voice of God is calling to the harvest, calling you. Little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go. Does the place you're called to labor seem so small and little known? It is great if God is in it, and He'll not forget His own. Little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go in Jesus' name. Are you laid aside from service, body worn from toil and care? You can still be in the battle, in the sacred place of prayer. Little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go. Conflict here is ended, and a race on earth is run. He will say to all the faithful, welcome home, my child, well done. Little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go.
All right, good morning. Y'all want to go outside and have church outside? Man, it's nice out there. I hope it never gets to 150 degrees here again. All right, announcements. Public Ministry Thursday in Kennedy, 10:30 a.m. Had a good one last Thursday, and then Saturday, last night, Josh was over there, and Marcy, were you? You came for a little bit. Yeah, that's right. You were here for a little bit. All right. Had a good outreach. And more just seems like that's kind of the avenue or an avenue to get the people thinking about Jesus Christ and getting scriptures in people's minds that otherwise wouldn't be there. Also, as far as individual public ministry stuff like that you guys want to participate in, we've got door hangers down here. I've got routes and everything. The city's all kind of mapped out. If you're interested in doing that, then tracks. We got Bibles. We got marked verses in the Bibles back there in the back in another building. There's a lot of ways to get the gospel out to folks. Of course, in your relationships with people you work with and school and things like that. So lots of opportunities. I encourage you to take tracks with you and take Bibles, you know, take that stuff with you and be diligent to be a good ambassador for Jesus Christ. So those are the announcements. I don't think there's any other activities going on for this month. So, Alan, how about you come on up here?
Hello, everybody.
Hello.
No, I didn't bring a songbook. I'm not going to sing. But that song, that last one, Ben put there, little as much when God is in it. Wow, labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go in Jesus' name. And that fits with the missionary update. I just thought that that was just a lot of powerful words in there. And I had this little short reading out of the Chick newsletter I thought was real strong, and I wanted to read it to you first. This gentleman, RG, from New Jersey. I left tracks in Walmart bathrooms. I was putting tracks out when a Spanish guy asked me if I was the one putting tracks in the bathrooms at the store. I said, yes. He said his friend, a real bad dude, had found one. He read it before going back to Mexico. He got saved, or God saved him, and now he is a pastor in Mexico because of Chick tracks. I thought, wow. I thought that was, you know, we all ought to be putting them in bathrooms and gas stations and wherever we can. No, I'm not going to get the wrong thing there. Sharing, being ministers for God, being disciples for the Lord Jesus Christ. Today's missionary report is the Dasal family in Peru, South America. And a couple of, I'm going to throw two together real quick. He just mentioned the restaurants and commercial shopping back in June. He said they were at 50% of normal capacity, but public gatherings and church service were still not allowed. So that was in June. He also mentioned that June 5th, we received a call, and Miss Dasal, her father, Wes Perkins, was taken a significant decline. He passed away on June 7th. So they thanked people for prayers and prayed for the family. They thanked the Lord he didn't suffer too long. And also then Stacy Dasal, his mother had major surgery, and then the father couldn't be with them, but they spent several weeks with them, and also with their children, Tim and Catherine and Matthew and Naomi, who are getting into the ministry, and Rebecca successfully completed the ninth grade. On other things, their specific prayer requests are health and safety for the people there, their return to work and experience winter in Peru, the economy recovery for their families and in their countries from devastation caused by the pandemic and civil unrest, spiritual guidance as we continue to minister to our families and to others while stateside, because they're here in the States now. Like United States, Peru is trying to reopen as many businesses as possible to keep the economy from a total ruin and experiencing similar results. National transportation started back in mid-July with planes, buses, and five provinces are under strict quarantine. And at least one of their church members experienced yesterday that Peru may reinstate many of the quarantine protocols. So this was in July, so I don't know how it is exactly today, but keep praying for them on that. And on a positive note, it appears that all the men are back to work and those persons that were infected have recovered. Their services are moving forward without any hindrance. And so we have missed only three services since going online, and that was only due to travel and scheduled meetings that were in Maine. With that, Pastor Alex filled in, and so the other people continue to be fed. While we try to maintain the focus of our newsletters on others, we do want to share from time to time about how it impacts them as well. We are thankful that our support has remained stable and that we have a place to stay for the duration of whatever time we are here in the States. On the flip side, an extended time in the States has significant impact on the residency visas and other legal documents. Won't go into all the details, but pray for all their visas and such and health things that they get those back straightened out. And since we will be stateside for more than 6 months as well, we are not sure what options will be available at that time, so it could affect that. We obviously want to be back home as quickly as reasonable and safe to do so. In the meantime, we keep doing what we are doing on the side here of the equator, and they appreciate all our prayers and financial support for their family. And until the nets are full, fit with morning's Bible study, Stacy and Jennifer Dasal. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you for the Dasals in Peru who are here now, that you bless them while they're here, bless their family, that you be with all the people returning to work there in Peru, for that you would bring civil unrest to more peace and calmness, and that you guide each one of them, and for the families there, for the devastations during the pandemic and the issues going on in their country, and for spiritual guidance as they continue to minister to their families and others while they're stateside. And for, again, for our local missionary outreaches here, for Josh and his, and for Brian and Robert and I here, and any others want to join us and during weekdays, we have several times available that you could join folks. And we thank you for all these things, and help us to minister for the Lord Jesus Christ. In his name we ask it. Amen. Thank you. Brother Brian.
All right. I just realized I went out of order, didn't I? Alan usually goes first. Wow. Change it all up. We'll just mix it up. Who knows, you know. All right. I have a couple men come forward, and they'll take up our offering this morning. And I will tell you about this. I know y'all are all wondering, what is that thing on the pulpit? I'll let you know. Craig, how about you pray for us?
Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to be here again this morning and worship you. And Lord, just start out by saying we love you. We thank you for what you've done for us. And God, hearing Alan read the missionary letters, Lord, we just pray for the missionaries around the world. We know that some of them are stuck here, Lord, and some of them are stuck in other countries. God, be with them. God, I know their hearts are to serve you, so no matter where they are, they're going to be witnessing and doing outreach, whatever they can do, Lord, but their hearts are on their in their countries and in the field that you call them to, Lord. Pray that you would bless them, get them back there according to your will, Lord. And God, what a wonderful thing to hear about our own missionary outreach around here in Beeville and the surrounding areas, Lord, as you begin, continue to bless and guide and direct, Lord. And I pray that you would touch hearts, Lord.
Amen.
And Lord, I pray about the service this morning, Lord, that you would touch the folks that are here. Lord, open our ears, soften our hearts to your word. Lord, that we would learn something about you, Lord, learn something about ourselves, and God, that we would be able to serve you better, and Lord, be better Christians and have a better relationship with you. All these things, we love you, thank you, and praise you. In Jesus' name, we pray.
Amen. All right. Turn your Bibles to 1 Samuel chapter 5. 1 Samuel chapter 5. And while you're turning there, I'll explain what we got up here. So, I got to be careful with it. So, in 1 Samuel, we're kind of following the path of the Ark of the Covenant. And this is a replica of the Ark of the Covenant. That's what it looked like. And so I'll leave it up here and you guys can come look at it. It's not a toy or anything, so please don't touch it or anything like that. But anyhow, this is what it looks like. You got the cherubim on top. You had inside, you had the manna, you had Aaron's rod that budded, you had Moses' tables there. And this is the piece of furniture that went into the tabernacle, and it was in the Holy of Holies, and it was where God would meet with the high priest. And as we read, I mean, you'll hear the Ark of the Covenant mentioned multiple times in this chapter and in the next chapter. As you heard the chapter before, it was mentioned several times. And you're really following the path of the Ark of the Covenant as it goes out of the hands of the Israelites into the hands of the Philistines. And it's kind of like a hot potato. I mean, when the Philistines get it, they don't know what to do with it. And some things happened to the Philistines that are kind of funny, to say the least. And they try to get rid of it, and they get all their witch doctors together to figure out, what do we do with this thing? And they ended up basically putting this ark on a cart and just sending the cart back to Israel. Just let the cows get back to Israel, and they stop somewhere. We'll deal with that in the next chapter. But 1 Samuel chapter 5 is really, really an interesting chapter in the Bible, and it really defines holy and unholy things. And when the Philistines, after their battle and warfare with Israel, they capture the ark. In 1 Samuel chapter 5, this is what happens. Verse 1. The Philistines took the ark of God and brought it from Ebenezer unto Ashdod. When the Philistines took the ark of God, they brought it into the house of Dagon and set it by Dagon. And when they of Ashdod arose early on the morrow, behold, Dagon was fallen upon his face to the earth before the ark of the Lord. And they took Dagon and set him in his place again. You understand what's going on? This God that they're worshiping can't do anything for itself. And so the ark is placed in the same temple with this God. And Dagon is kind of like this Aquaman figure. I mean, he's like fish and man and all that stuff. And you can relate, you know, Aquaman. So I say Aquaman. He's like this Aquaman figure. And when the Philistines show up the next morning, Dagon is on his face, and they got to pick him back up and prop up this thing so they can continue to worship this dumb god. Then verse 4, when they arose early on the morrow morning, behold, Dagon was fallen upon his face to the ground before the ark of the Lord. And the head of Dagon and both the palms of his hands were cut off upon the threshold. Only the stump of Dagon was left to him. Therefore, neither the priests of Dagon nor any that come into Dagon's house tread on the threshold of Dagon and Ashdod unto this day. But the hand of the Lord was heavy upon them of Ashdod, and he destroyed them and smote them with emerods, even unto Ashdod and the coast thereof. You say, what are emerods? Emerods are hemorrhoids. That's what they are. But it sounds like it gets worse than that. It sounds like it gets even worse than that. Verse 7, and when the men of Ashdod saw that it was so, they said, the ark of God of Israel shall not abide with us. Get this thing out of here. We don't want this thing here. For his hand is sore upon us and upon Dagon our God. They sent therefore and gathered all the lords of the Philistines unto them and said, what shall we do with the ark of the God of Israel? And they answered, let the ark of the God of Israel be carried unto Gath. And they carried the ark of the God of Israel about thither. And it was so that after they had carried it about, the hand of the Lord was against the city with very great destruction. And he smote the men of the city, both small and great, and they had emerods in their secret parts. Wow, this thing is a real pandemic. Therefore, they sent the ark of God to Ekron. So here, it's just a hot potato is what it is. It goes to Ashdod, then bad things start happening in Ashdod, and the temple of Dagon, the god of that city, has fallen on his face. They prop him up. The next day, he's falling on his face. His head's off. His arms are off. His hands are off. And the people of Ashdod say, get this thing. We don't want this thing here. And so they send it over to, I think Ekron is the next place they send it to. Gath. They send it to Gath. Well, same thing starts happening in Gath. People start getting sick. People start dying. And the people of Gath say, we don't want this thing here. Get it out of here. And then they send it to Ekron. And the people of Ekron, guess what happens there? People get sick, people die, and they say, we don't want this thing here, get it out of here. Verse 10, therefore they sent the ark of God to Ekron. Came to pass as the ark of God came to Ekron that the Ekronites cried out, saying, they have brought about the ark of God of Israel to us to slay us and our people. So apparently the Ekronites have already heard what's happening in Ashdod and Gath, And they see somebody bringing this ark to their town, and they're like, "Get that! No, 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 no! Get that thing! We don't want that thing near us! Get it out of here!" Verse 11. So they sent and gathered together all the lords of the Philistines. So they gather up all their wise counselors, and what do we do with this? And said, "Send away the ark of God of Israel, and let it go again to his own place, that it slay us not and our people, for there was a deadly destruction throughout all the city. The hand of God was very heavy there. And the men that died not were smitten with the emerods, and the cry of the city went up to heaven." Man, what a mess. I mean, it's just it captured this ark, and you've read what happens. It's like a hot potato from city to city. You'll find out it ends up going to five different cities. And you'll see that in the next chapter. It goes to five different cities before the Philistines just say, "Get this thing out of our country. We don't want this thing here anymore. It has bad mojo on it. We don't want it. Get it out of here." And you'll see that in the next chapter. So let's pray real quick one more time. And I'm going to give you a few things from this chapter about holy versus unholy, or holy and unholy things. But let's pray one more time real quick. Father, I pray that you'd help us with this service, with this lesson. Help us distinguish between the holy and the unholy. And I pray that you would guide and direct us in this. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. The first thing to notice in this chapter, when the Philistines get this ark, they take it to their god there. Their Dagon is their god, their idol. And if you don't see it a whole lot here in this country generally, but if you've ever traveled to other countries, you see idolatry where there are houses for gods and I mean on very evident, and there's food offerings and there's all kinds of stuff. And I remember going to Trinidad one year, probably 10 years ago now, but anyhow, the we were staying at one house, and next door there's a guy, and he had these idols, and he had all this food out and stuff like that for all these idols in front of his house, and that's pretty common. And they're just making these offerings to these pieces of plastic and pieces of wood. And I mean, you could go and kick the piece of wood down, and it's shaped like a something, and it wouldn't get back up, and it wouldn't do anything, and it wouldn't fight back, and it wouldn't do it. It wouldn't hurt you in any way, and in fact, it couldn't even stand itself back up. I mean, it would just lay there. That's what happens with the Philistines. They take the ark, they put it in the house of Dagon, and in 24 hours' time, they come in the next morning, and Dagon's on his face. And the ark is there. But I want you to get this point. The difference between something holy and unholy is this. Number one, Dagon, this god, this idol, has no trouble sharing glory with some other god. But you put that shoe on the other foot. In God Almighty's tabernacle, he would never allow idols to just show up and be set around in his tabernacle. Moses could not, Aaron could not take some other god of some other, you know, culture or whatever and bring it into the Holy of Holies and just set it in there. That would be totally off limits. But Dagon, idolaters, idolatry, it doesn't really make any difference because nothing's really sacred. It doesn't matter. So they take this piece of furniture, this religious item, this Ark of the Covenant, and they just go ahead and put it in the same house with Dagon. Now, you understand the difference. Dagon, unholy, idol, can't hear, can't see, but the people's understanding of gods and religion is, it's nothing really sacred about it. Just put this thing with this other, with this other god, and we just have a house for all our gods here. But no one true God. On the other hand, the one true God, he says things like, "I am the way, the truth, the life, exclusive. Meaning you don't bring other gods into my house and I just share glory with them. I don't accept that. So, unholy, here's this idol, Dagon. It has no feelings whatsoever, no thoughts whatsoever, can't see, can't hear. It's just an inanimate object, piece of wood, piece of rock, piece of plastic, whatever it is. And it's shaped like something. But it has no power, no ability. And it doesn't care if other idols are thrown in the mix with it. I mean, it's just inanimate. But the one true God, he doesn't share glory with a bunch of other things. Like Jesus Christ said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Paul says it this way. He says, what fellowship hath light with darkness? There is no fellowship with light with darkness. They don't come together and agree on anything. Jesus Christ said this. He says, you cannot serve two masters. I don't accept and I don't allow, I don't share my glory, my relationship. I don't share this with other gods. In fact, there are no other gods. You read that in Psalms. He says, there are no other gods besides me. Lord would never allow idols to sit in his tabernacle. God's not going to share his glory. The Bible, the Word of God is exclusive. And people get troubled by that. People say, why is it so exclusive? Why do you say only this way and not this other way? Or why do you say only this and not this? Well, because this other thing you're pointing to isn't a way. It isn't life. It doesn't offer anything. There's only one way. There's only one life. Jesus Christ, the way, the truth, and the life. Y'all know that. But just recognize the attitude of unbelievers and their idols versus the attitude of God's people and God Almighty. The idolaters, the idols, they don't have any feelings one way or another, whether other things are in their house or not. Dagon is just some inanimate thing. But the people that set up the tabernacle of Dagon, the people that set up Dagon, they don't even recognize that Dagon cares about anything else being in his house. On the other hand, God would care. He definitely cares about other things being in his house. So it's a place of exclusion. It's a place of exclusion versus a place of inclusion. God is so gracious to provide any way of salvation, and he's provided a way of salvation. But it's not just anything that comes to your mind as a way of salvation. He's made a way, and he's told you what the way is. So it's a place of exclusion. Unholy versus holy. Unholy, inclusive, just whatever floats your boat, show up, bring it to the house of God, whatever. On the other hand, holy is exclusive. I don't share glory with anyone. I don't share my throne with anyone. That's exclusion versus inclusion. And it's the attitude of the worshipers. And you'll find the Philistines, the Philistines are just good Americans. You know, they're just good Americans. They got their idols. They got their superstitions about how God works and how religion's supposed to work. And you notice after Dagon falls down, he falls down one time, and what do they do? What do these guys do? They pick him back up and set him up. Who in their right mind, thinks if you have to pick up a God who can't stand on his own is worthy of worship? Who in their right mind attributes power to some piece of plastic, wood, rock that can't hear, see, taste, feel, has no idea what you're saying because it's just an inanimate object? Yeah, it may be shaped like a saint or whatever. It may be shaped like something. But I guarantee you, you talk to that little thing and it doesn't hear you. And it doesn't know what you're saying. And if it fell on the ground, you'd have to pick it back up. That's idolaters. That stuff is just in our flesh. We as human beings, We like to be able to see what we're worshiping. So we'll make an image of it. We'll make a replica of it so we can see what we're worshiping. The Lord says, look, you're going to have to come to me by faith. You're going to have to listen to what I said. And that's how you're going to get to know me. First thing, place of exclusion versus place of inclusion. And then, of course, we touched on the second point. There's a powerful God here at work versus just an impotent idol. This God, after the first time he falls down, the Philistines go in, they pick him back up. I watched this video, it's been a while. And it's sad to watch. Sad to watch this stuff. But I watch these folks, they parade this statue of Mary through whatever it is. I don't know if it's a street or even a church maybe. But they're parading this statue of Mary. You know that statue can't hear, can't respond, has no power. And then, God forbid, somebody tripped and the statue fell. And it fell on the ground. And you could hear the audible gasp like, oh. You understand all of this religion is in the minds of the people. The statue didn't feel anything. And when it fell on the ground, you know what the people did? They ran over to pick it back up. You know why they did that? Because it can't stand up. It can't hear. It can't respond. It can't speak. It can't even stand on its own unless you make it stand up. So they went and they picked it back up and they set it back on this tray. And it's just like, that is religion. That's what people think religion is. That's what people think worshiping God is. That's what the Philistines think worshiping God is. Pick up Dagon, put him back. Oh, Dagon, yeah, bless Dagon. And then the second day, after they pick it back up, falls down again. But this time the Lord makes it a little bit more poignant. Falls down the second time, and the head's off of it. And the hands are off of it. So it's just in pieces on the ground in this tabernacle. I imagine the priest of Dagon are kind of like, man, I don't know. I mean, what happened? What do we do here? It maybe our occupation is at stake here. I don't know. But this God, what do we do? Well, let's, I don't know, find some glue. Somebody know how to put this thing back together? I mean, just the thought of that. So the thing falls down. Its head's off. Its hands are off. And they're in the threshold of the door. Just imagine the door. And Dagon is like this. The head's off. Little Aquaman statue or whatever. Heads off, hands are off, they're laying in the threshold. So here's what's said about the Philistines. Superstitious. Here's what they say. Verse 5. Therefore, neither the priests of Dagon nor any that come into Dagon's house tread on the threshold of Dagon in Ashdod unto this day. So here it is. You've heard probably things like, what is it? Step on a crack, break your back. Something like that. So you know what they do? They get to the threshold of Dagon and they, whoop, don't step on it because that's where the head and the hands were at one time. So they hop over that and they tell everybody, you can't step on the threshold in the tabernacle. You can't, don't step on it. So it becomes this superstition. Hey, step on a crack, break your back. Where does this stuff come? Who says this? This God that is impotent. It has no power. It's broken into pieces. And it doesn't, I don't know what they do with it after this. It doesn't say they glue it back together or anything. I don't know what they do with it. They do something because it shows up later on in the Bible. But they do something with it. But after this, there's this superstition created around this thing because this is where the hands were. This is where the head was. And so, you know, don't step on the threshold of the doorway or something. Here it is. Something bad will happen to you if you step on the threshold. So that's what you just read. That's superstition. That's how religion, just baseless nonsense, permeates the ideas and the imaginations of people. They have no idea what they're talking about. They think that the threshold is cursed. No, the threshold isn't cursed. Your whole religion is cursed. Your whole idolatrous religion is cursed. It's not the threshold of the door that's bad. It's the idol that's bad. It's the tabernacle that's bad. It's the whole thing. Powerful God versus impotent idol. On the other hand, so here's Dagon, falling down on his face, broken in pieces. But here's the ark of God. And God just seemed to decide, you know what, I'm just going to show my hand here. And the ark of God, God just defends himself. You put this thing in this tabernacle with this other idol, I'm not going to be around this other idol. Wham! So then the priests in Ashdod and all the ones running the temple say, we got to get this thing out of here. But before they do, they find out people in the city are starting to get sick. Wow. They're getting sick. So you've got a powerful God, God Almighty, who can fully defend himself. He doesn't need an army of Israel. He doesn't need people. He doesn't need anything. He fully is capable of defending his own territory, his own things. He's fully capable of defending that. Versus this other God who has no power whatsoever to do anything, and all the power of this other imaginary God is just in the imaginations of the people. Then the heavy hand of God, verse 6. this is bad. But the hand of the Lord was heavy upon them at Ashdod, and he destroyed them. Now the hand of the Lord, the heavy hand of God, shows up 3 or 4 times in this chapter. And it's like God just decided to show his hand, and he just, look, I'm not going to put up with this. I don't need Israel to fight for me. I don't need people. I am fully capable of destroying any idols or idolatry or religion that is counterproductive, that is satanic, that is devilish, that is all those things, that takes emphasis off of God Almighty. So the hand of the Lord, verse 6, was heavy upon them of Ashdod, and he destroyed them. So that's worse than just hemorrhoids. That's death. He destroyed them and smote them with emerods, even Ashdod and the coasts thereof. And when the men of Ashdod saw that it was so, they said, the ark of God of Israel shall not abide with us, for his hand is sore upon us and upon Dagon our God. Yeah, get this thing out of here. And so they send it away. After it's just left a wake of destruction here in Ashdod, they say, get it out of here. And they send it away. Here's just a thought. You might have heard this said before, that God's judgment on people when people reject Jesus Christ, that hell and things like that are the absence of God. It's just God being away from people. That's judgment. You may have heard that. I've heard people preach that. It's just the absence of God. It's not really hellfire. It's just the absence of God. When you read this, these Philistines, they don't want anything to do with the presence of God. And you find that's most people. I just, God is too inconvenient. I mean, he just has these, it just seems overbearing. And so the judgment of God is not that, you know, he just allows whatever, or it's the separation, that's the phrase I'm looking for. Judgment of God is the separation of God from people. Well, these people would love to be separated from God. They don't want anything to do with God. And the people in Ashdod, they say, get this thing out of our city. Get it out of here. And they're probably good Americans. God is too overbearing. He makes too many demands. He's too exclusive. He doesn't incorporate other people. He's unmerciful. It's just too much. I mean, I'll take a little bit of God, but you know, just let's not get overboard with this thing. That's most people. That's the general rule. That's all of our flesh is like that. You're here. You got a body. This body is at enmity with God. And when God says something, this flesh says, no, I don't want to do that. I don't like that. I'm not into that. I'm not interested. I don't have time for that. You'll find that the heathen will come to, they really come to hate the presence of God. And it reminds me of a verse in the New Testament. The heathen come to hate the presence of God. Paul said to Timothy one time, we read it in Sunday school, he says, look, there's going to come a time when people will just not endure sound doctrine. They're just not going to put up with it. You know what the Ashdodites and the Philistines here and the Ekronites, they just aren't going to put up with the presence of God. They don't want it around them. They got their own lives to live. It's hurting their idols. It's hurting their income. It's hurting their lifestyle. Just get this thing out so we can live our lives the way we want to live our lives. Does that mean we're not going to be atheists? No, we'll be religious people. We'll be church-going people, but we don't want God involved in this. God's too demanding. The heathen will come to hate the presence of God. There's coming a time that don't endure sound doctrine. It means they just don't put up with holiness. Then this thing here, verse 10. The reality is, and the sooner we all come to recognize this truth, the better off we'll all be, including me, including everyone. God Almighty is going to be magnified among the heathen no matter what. No matter what. Whether you're disobedient, whether you're obedient, whether you love Him, whether you hate Him, it matters to you. But God's going to be magnified no matter what. More specifically, Jesus Christ is going to be magnified among the heathen no matter what. So the ark goes to Ekron in verse 10. And Ekron, just a little bit of history here. Ekron is like a major, these are all five major cities. It's like, you know, Chicago, New York, Houston, Dallas. If the ark, if you imagine the ark in the United States of America, this is just bringing it to a modern day thing, and it traveled to Chicago, and all of a sudden people in Chicago started getting sick, and these things started falling down on the ground, and then the people in Chicago and the city council said, get this thing out of here, we don't want this thing. And so they send it away, and they send it to Dallas, and in Dallas people start getting sick all over the place. And these idols, the religion starts to fall apart, and people in Dallas say, get this thing out of here. We don't want this thing here. That's the idea. It goes to these major cities, and Ekron happens to be kind of like a capital. It's where, if you remember, Jesus Christ was, he was accused of being from Beelzebub. Well, Beelzebub was the big god in Ekron. Beelzebub, they said he's the prince of the gods. This guy's kind of the overseer of all these other gods. And so he goes to, or in the account here, the ark's going to go to Ekron. And the people in Ekron have already heard what happened in Ashdod and what happened in Gaza. And they are just not interested at all. Verse 10, therefore they sent the ark of God to Ekron. And it came to pass, as the ark of God came to Ekron, that the Ekronites cried out, saying, they have brought about the ark of God out of Israel to us to slay us and our people. they're trying to kill us here. They're trying to kill us. This thing, everywhere it goes, it hurts people. It's just, and it destroys religions everywhere it goes. Just keep that thing away from us. And so the Ekronites, they don't want it at all. Verse 11, so they sent and gathered together all the lords of the Philistines and said, send away the ark of God of Israel and let it go again to his own place, that it slay us not and our people. For there was a deadly destruction throughout all the city. The hand of God was very heavy there. And the men that died not were smitten with the emerods, and the cry of the city went up to heaven. It reminds me of this. The point is simply this. God's going to be magnified among the heathen no matter what. No matter what. Particularly, Jesus Christ is going to be magnified among the world no matter what. They say in Ekron, this God has no place with us. No place. We don't have a place for this thing. Get it out of here and send it to its own place. Get it out of here. And it reminds me of Revelation chapter 9. I'll just read this one to you. After God has judged people in tribulation and all the bad things that happen in Revelation, this is what the people say. And the rest of the men which were not killed by these plagues, yet repented not of the works of their hands, that they should not worship devils and idols of gold and silver and brass and stone and of wood. Listen to this. Which neither can see nor hear nor walk. Neither repented they of their murders nor of their sorceries nor of their fornication nor of their thefts. Some people in Revelation 9, they suffer immensely under the heavy hand of God. And instead of saying, God, my problem is I am not right with you. I want to be right with you. Lord, help me. Get me away from my sin and my idols. Help me be right with you. But instead of saying that, they say, God, we don't want God anywhere near us. And he says in Revelation, they neither repented of their idolatry, they didn't stop killing each other, they didn't stop stealing from each other. All they wanted was to be comfortable, and their comfort was God leaving their presence. Get out of here so we can live our lives. That's the Philistines. That's the people in Revelation 9. Under and after a period of time of God's judgment and heavy-handedness, the people still don't repent. They're still not interested in being right with God. They want to hang on to these idols that can't hear, can't talk, can't see, can't answer prayers. They can't do anything. But they basically look at God and say, get away from us. We want our wood and our stone and our plastic and all of these things we call gods. We're going to hang on to these, and we want you to get away from us. You know, God's going to, as we mentioned, God's going to be magnified among the heathen no matter what. I say this to kind of wrap this thing up, because you've seen the chapter, you see what happens. This world, to some folks, as we talked about in Sunday school, when Jesus Christ returns, it is the end of this world. And to some people, that is a tragic, tragic time. The end of this world. But to other people, when Jesus Christ returns, it is a glorious, glorious time of righteousness. And this present evil world and the unrighteousness that fills politics and the wickedness that fills legislation and policies, all of that stuff is flushed out under Jesus Christ. But some people, they don't want to see that stuff flushed out. They want to hang on to all that wickedness. They want to live in this present evil world and, I guess, enjoy the pleasures of this world. And when Jesus Christ returns, they don't want to have, they don't want to see him. They don't want to have anything to do with him. And so to some group, to one group of people, Jesus Christ showing up in his glory and the end of this world is a terrible tragedy. But to another group, the end of this present evil world is a blessing. It is a blessing. Now you can guess what group the Philistines are in here. They just want to see God's presence out. Get it out of here. Get it out of our policies. Get it out of our legislation. Get God away from our culture. Get him out of here. He's too demanding. We can't live our lives the way we want to live our lives. Get him out of here. So that ark, the presence of God, really the hand of God there, goes to Ashdod, does what it does. The people are, you know, I mean, they just get this thing out of here. They got the disease. They got Dagon falling on his face. Send him over to Gath. Same thing. Send it over to Ekron. Same thing. It just seems to get worse and worse and worse. And as I thought about putting chapter 5 and 6 together, but we'll just end it here in chapter 5 and deal with the rest of this in chapter 6. But there's a few things about being holy and being unholy here. First thing is this. Holiness is exclusive. Unholiness, just all inclusive, just whatever. Whatever you want goes. Hey, it's okay. But you'll notice in unholiness, it's not just kind of whatever. It's whatever as long as God's not involved in it. It's whatever as long as we don't have the presence of God with us. Unholy versus holy. You've got a powerful God versus just an impotent idol. You've got the heavy hand of God who can fight for himself versus an idol that has no power. It's got to be set up. It won't even stand up unless somebody picks it up. And then you've got the fact that God is going to be magnified among the heathen no matter what. And the sooner we get a hold of that, the better off we'll be. God is going to be magnified in this earth no matter what. It may not happen tomorrow, it may not happen a year from now, but one day the name of Jesus Christ will fill this earth. And he will be magnified in this place. And you want to be on the right side. You want to be on the right side. Because whatever it is we're working for, whatever it is we're trying to, our goals are, and what we want to achieve in this life, you better be sure it has something to do with the kingdom of Jesus Christ and when he returns. Better be sure that there's some investment into Jesus Christ. Because all this stuff is going away at some point. It's going away and it will be renovated. And to some, it's going to be a disaster. Don't let it be a disaster to you when it happens. Look forward to the blessed coming of Jesus Christ and the glorious appearing of Jesus Christ and the return of Jesus Christ. And when politics and all that stuff is ruled and reigned in righteousness, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Unholy versus holy. We'll stop there. We'll wrap it up here with chapter 5 and we'll continue with chapter 6 because there's some more things that happen here. But I hope that's helpful to you. I hope you learned some Bible. I hope you see some of the people. People haven't changed that much. Superstitious, religious, don't want God around them. We're all pretty much the same. People are pretty much the same. We haven't grown up too much in thousands of years here. But I hope that's helpful to you. Let's have a little, maybe just a little time of invitation as Sam plays a little bit. And we'll just pray. Pray where you are. Maybe just a couple minutes of reflection on all this. Holy versus unholy. Holy versus unholy. A holy God versus an unholy idol. Unholy people. Just reflect on some of these things. Sam, you can go ahead and start playing. Have a time of invitation. Think about these things that we've heard. Thank you. All right. You guys can look up here. God bless y'all for being here. I hope that's helpful. I hope you learned some Bible this morning. Learn a little bit about, more about the Lord. And next week we'll see the Philistines and their CDC get involved in all this. And they'll start trying to deal with the disease and figure out what do we do with this thing. And it'll be interesting. So, all right, Alan, how about you dismiss us in prayer?
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for allowing us to be here. We thank you for all the visitors and those that are joining us today. Thank you that you are a holy God, and you're a mighty God, and you're a jealous God and a vengeful God, and yet you're a loving God, that you loved us so much. You became a man, you came to earth to